about 12 shots in, and I got a plate of curly fries coming around. You like curly fries? Have a seat. Now, you'd think, as an analyst and a reviewer, it'd be hard to get my attention. But I'm as red-blooded as any other cat when it comes to the joys of gaming. Long-legged narratives and curvaceous dialogue. Golden, flowing locks of character development. I've had my heart set ablaze by a darling indie game subverting all expectations, and I've chased the dirty indulgences of sleepless nights with the tight gameplay and the hot graphics of a AAA midnight release. But there's an understated detail in games I feverishly lust after. Failure. No, not you. Be it failure in tech, communication, or game design, failure is the spice of life in video games. But there are a few in the industry who have taken to misusing the spice. Tech failure being the most obvious, there are empires built on optimized and streamlined products. They may not be the most innovative, but that's the price to pay for reliable cameras, movement, player models, bug-free-ish experiences, you name it. If you're hip with the jazz, then you know Blizzard polish, a term within the industry referring to quality assurance of the highest degree. The phrase itself is one of Blizzard's 8 core beliefs. And while I find that level of attention to detail admirable, I've grown to dislike the inflexible approach to bugs. Not all bugs are bad. Without them, there would be no dynamic difficulty curves, no attack combos, no warmongering Gandhi. All unintentional, but interesting enough to become widely recognized features. Blizzard's logic, that all points of failure are bad, has led them and anyone else following suit to aggressively grind the life out of their later releases alongside the imperfections instead of designing around them. There's still bugs because there's no such thing as a perfect game, but those aren't interesting. You threw out all the potentially juicy jank, or you try to implement it after the fact like pre-ripped jeans. Some do manage to look cool and rugged, while others look like a kindergartner's been crawling around in them. Anywho. Technological failures aside, the first point of failure is communication. From health bars to locked doors, we constantly need to know if we're doing all right, and if we're not, we need to be rerouted as quickly as possible so we don't wallow in our failures. Specifically, unspoken communication gets me going. Character body language helpfully redirecting my attention. Cleverly crafted maps deftly showing off where I'm going, where I've been. Most amusing are the planned failures of communication, the true masters. When a game goes against their own established norms and takes advantage of a presumed understanding. Why, yes, I am talking about From Software's chests, which gobble you up because you thought chests mean good. So you learn to tap them with your sword ahead of time to check for mimics, only for it to teleport you to the hostile lands of Gary, Indiana. And there happens to be a term you darling eggheads like to use called ludonarrative dissonance. In short, it means the story of the game is telling you one thing while the gameplay is telling you the exact opposite. Sounds like a dating nightmare, but conflicting communication isn't a bad thing in itself. It's downright necessary for games that beat down on their main characters, and who hasn't played one of those? God of War? Hellblade? They stand out in my memory because the gameplay provides me with gleeful abandon while Kratos and Senua, respectively, are going through literal hell and back. On the other hand, No Place for Bravery is afraid you won't get the tragic message of moving on. Stop playing this game, says the story. Stop playing this game, says the gameplay. Okay, says I. What we have on our hands is a failure to fail to communicate. That risk of failing to fail purposefully or failing accidentally leads games to be either too artistically obtuse, or to be oversaturated with directed dialogue, objective markers, written objectives, mini-maps, and keeps me on rails just to be safe. I suppose I can sympathize with Ubisoft's handholding, if only slightly. Better the player know exactly where they are and be annoyed, than be lost and annoyed. Likewise, developers can be shy when considering the possibility that their players might fail to begin with. What? My players would never. However, it is impossible to make a game that is entirely idiot-proof. There will always be a bigger idiot. Even if you're playing Minecraft on creative mode, you can misplace a block, but you simply knock it out, replace it, and you're back to finishing your golden cock lickety-split, because while not idiot-proof, it is possible to make games idiot-friendly. Oh, I could write ballads about level 1-1 from Super Mario Bros. The many questions it answers before a player even has a chance to ask them because Miyamoto and friends incorporated failure into the design. Super Meat Boy employs quick restarts, and when you complete a level, you get to see all your happy little accidents. In contrast, Dark Souls demolishes your ass, but then gives you a little time to stew on the defeat for a little bit so you can look at the health bar, keep in mind where your souls are gonna be, see a few extra moves from the boss, and cool off in between attempts. Anticipating failure is a chance to give players the tools for success. But failure in itself and of itself does not provide substance to games. A common misstep I've begun to notice more recently is a hyperfixation on failure from indie and AAA developers alike. Indie developers designing difficult games, namely Souls-likes, understand catharsis is key. Catharsis is the feeling of relief from stress and tension, so they stack the deck against their players. Enemies are designed with devastating attacks that are hard to understand or predict. Meanwhile, the maps are left uninspired, the movement is rigid, and the camera gets stuck on corners because they're potential points for player failure. All of this is a misguided way to increase catharsis. They sit there in discount underwear that comes in packs of 12 thinking, if I piss off the player more, it'll feel better when they win. And if they don't like it, then it's because they're bad, not my game. And AAA studios are on the other side of the same coin. I can practically see the reverse logic written on a whiteboard by a tyrannical CEO work-crunching their employees into a premature death. If failing equals not fun, then not failing equals fun. Genius, that. Instead of designing systems that are enjoyable in their own right, the systems are designed for you to not lose. But what are boss fights that you always win? What is loot that's always rewarding? What are choices that are always correct? Inconsequential. And in an effort to give back some of that lost meaning, failure just becomes the other option. My favorite example, and apparently the favorite example of some of my coworkers, is gear score. We're incentivized to equip loot that is just barely better than what we already have in modern games. Not because we actually feel any joy from that particular piece of loot, but because if we don't equip it, we will fail, and failing is not fun. At its best, it's lazy and uninspiring, but at its worst, it's manipulative. It's the sneaky way companies get rich off of predatory practices that aren't technically pay to win. They didn't do it by making better games, they did it by failing better. She's a cruel mistress, failure is. Inspires advancements in game tech, communication, and design philosophy like Cuphead, but also misleads and brings out the worst in my fellow man all for the sake of a quick buck a la Diablo Immortal. But maybe that's just the curly fries talking. You tell me. Leave a comment, but know this. I'm not here to convert you to my views. Hell, maybe I like your tune better. As for my credentials, I'm a video game industry insider adjacent, meaning I write for and about games and I do voiceovers for games, but most importantly, I'm a conversationalist. That's a fancy old French word for talks out of his ass.